Depending on how active you are on social media, and how closely you follow the weird and wonderful world of CONCACAF, you may or may not have come across some of these images over the last couple of weeks. And the story of Ronnie Brunswijk, Suriname's 60-year-old vice president who played 54 minutes of football against CD Olympia in the CONCACAF League last week, becoming the oldest player to ever appear in a game of football in a competitive international club competition. I certainly didn't miss it, since my phone lit up with hundreds of notifications after I landed in Greece on the day that it happened, September 21st, 2021, with many of you tagging me in tweets about it or bringing it to my attention by various other means. Some just to say, have you seen this? It's quite funny or interesting. But most of you asking me to give it, as all of the cool kids are calling it these days, the HITC Sevens treatment. I suspect that's because I tend to explore slightly more unusual topics on this channel than most football YouTube channels, and I also made in-depth videos following somewhat similar themes with regards to this viral photograph of the perhaps a little less athletic-looking footballer than most in China, and this viral meme known as Lonely Fan, who is now the president of his boyhood club in Brazil. I promised my beautiful, effervescent, and just generally wonderful girlfriend a work-free week on an extortionately overpriced Greek island, though, and I stayed true to my word. But as soon as I returned home, complete with a fresh tan, but very little disposable income, my attention quickly turned to Ronnie Brunswijk. Any of you who watched either the chubby Chinese owner or blue Brazilian fan videos that I alluded to just a moment ago will be well aware that in both of those instances, there was far more to those stories than initially met the eye. And in the case of the Chinese one, what initially met the eye and was widely reported basically turned out to be completely untrue. So I didn't want to make an entire video about Ronnie Brunswijk if the story didn't go much further than what had already been widely circulated on social media. That is to say, he's 60 years old, he's Suriname's vice president, and he started a game in the CONCACAF League for a team that he owns. Because, you know, I wouldn't wish to shortchange you like that. Thankfully, once again, that wasn't the case. In fact, there's an awful lot more to this story, and to the story of Ronnie Brunswijk, than one could ever wish to condense into 280 characters in a tweet. It is tough enough to condense it all into a single YouTube video, but hopefully we'll manage to pack in all of the juicy details, adding some much needed context, and, accidentally, telling much of the history of Suriname, post-independence, all through the lens of football. Ronnie Brunswijk is a man who the New York Times once described as, quote, an elite paratrooper, a soccer player, a wanted bank robber, a guerrilla leader, a gold baron, and a father to at least 50 children. Which is a hell of a description. I think you'd agree that it beats YouTuber by a fair old margin. And that was written before the vice president's most recent footballing exploits, from his passing precision as boasted about on his Wikipedia page, to cash rewards handed out to his own team's opponents. With that kind of introduction, you could be forgiven for asking the question, is there anything that Ronnie Brunswijk can't do? To which the answer is yes, he can't leave Suriname because there is an international arrest warrant out for him due to overseas convictions of drug trafficking, and if that hasn't sufficiently piqued your interest, just wait until you hear how he used to behave during some of his club's games. That's right, there's plenty to unpack here. So sit back, relax, and join me on a journey to Suriname. In a video that could become part of a larger series, which I might entitle Now That's What I Call CONCACAF, as we travel to the smallest country in South America by both size and population, and to a part of the country that is all too often overlooked, not just internationally, but within Suriname itself, creating an angst which has allowed Ronnie Brunswijk to become very popular indeed, attaining high office despite being on Interpol's red notice, and ultimately, to start himself in a competitive football match, for a club that he owns, in a stadium that he named after himself. Sometimes whilst I'm planning one of these types of videos, which include a focus on a relatively unknown figure from within the world of football, if not more broadly, I check out of curiosity to see whether they are on the famously comprehensive Football Manager Editor database. More often than not, they are, though they tend to have fairly sparse profiles and are sometimes just listed as being non-players and non-staff with no data at all. Brunswijk has a rather more extensive profile on the game though, rather amusingly, listed as having a 20 rating for both ambition and controversy, but 3, 4, and 2 as his ratings when it comes to professionalism, sportsmanship, and temperament, which rather chimes with the rest of my research. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the Football Manager series, those ratings are on a scale of 1 to 20, and extremes like that are fairly unusual, meaning the researchers think Brunswijk is simultaneously one of the most ambitious and controversial individuals in the entire world of football, but also one of the least professional, least sportsmanlike, and with one of the worst temperaments. Only 25 people even have 20 ambition and controversy alone, including Zlatan Ibrahimovic, and only one guy, the chairman of an Algerian team named Mohamed Zerouti, who presumably is also quite an interesting character, has the same extremes as Brunswijk. So who is Ronnie Brunswijk? And why do Football Manager seem to think he's basically some crazy, overly ambitious psychopath who'll bite your head off if you look at it in the wrong way? We'll start with where he was born. Not because I'm about to launch into some kind of dull biography of his life in a chronological order, but because it is pretty pivotal to this entire tale. Brunswijk was born in the village of Moivana in the Maravine district in Suriname's northeast coast. And I apologise in advance to any Surinamese viewers for any mispronunciations, of which I'm sure there are many, in this video. When he was born in 1961, Suriname was still controlled by the Netherlands, no longer officially designated as a colony, but as a constituent country of the Kingdom of the Netherlands, a status it had been promoted to in 1954. Brunswijk was 14 years old when Suriname gained independence from the Netherlands, as Suriname's former governor, Johan Ferrier, was installed as president of the newly independent nation, with Henk Arron appointed as prime minister. One third of Suriname's population emigrated to the Netherlands in the years leading up to independence, fearing the fallout from a tumultuous transition period, which is one of the reasons why we have seen so many players who were either born in Suriname or are of Surinamese descent representing the Netherlands over the years, whether that be Edgar Davids, Clarence Seedorf, Jorginho Wijnaldum, or Virgil van Dijk. Those who emigrated would be proven right in terms of the chaos that was to come, though the mass brain drain and evacuation of the working age population most likely made that something of a self-fulfilling prophecy. Whilst all of this was going on, Ronnie Brunswijk was already exhibiting signs of that 20 ambition that Football Manager accredits him with, becoming the first member of his enormous family to leave the village of Moivana. Both Moivana and the Maravine district more broadly are among the poorest parts of Suriname, often described as having been left behind in both colonial and post-independence times. Brunswijk was one of 10 surviving siblings, and his family worked tirelessly as subsistence farmers, meaning they farmed solely to feed themselves, surviving on a meagre diet of cassava, bananas, and rice, along with the very occasional luxury of meat when either Brunswijk or his brothers managed to successfully hunt down an animal using their swords. It was a hard life. Not just for the Brunswijks, but for all of the families living in a part of Suriname which is dominated by a group of people known as the Maroons, descendants of Africans in the Americas who formed settlements separate from slavery. Brunswijk broke free from this perpetual cycle of strife at the age of 10 when he was the only one of his 10 siblings to be invited to attend a boarding school in a nearby town by a Roman Catholic priest, discovering electricity for the first time when he arrived at the school in the early 1970s. After excelling at school, Brunswijk headed to Suriname's capital of Paramaribo to further his education. But at the same time, Suriname's unstable post-independence regime was on the verge of collapse. Plagued by an economic depression, social unrest, and accusations of corruption, the government of Johan Ferrier and Henk Arron was overthrown in 1980 in a violent coup d'etat led by Desé Bouterse and his Surinamese armed forces. After seizing power, Bouterse established a military dictatorship which cracked down on opposition parties, press freedoms, and even implemented a nationwide evening curfew. Brunswijk was one of many young Surinamese men to be drafted into the dictatorship's armed forces, where his strength and aptitude quickly caught the attention of Bouterse himself. Brunswijk was one of Suriname's first 12 paratroopers and the most highly regarded of the lot, sent off for training in Cuba before being handpicked by Butese as his own personal bodyguard. The two formed a close bond, with Brunswijk even attempting to take a bullet for Butese once, but their relationship came crashing down in 1984. Legend has it that Brunswijk requested a pay rise for his services as Butese's bodyguard, but that Suriname's authoritarian de facto ruler responded not only with a firm no, but by relieving Brunswijk from his post. That is my polite way of saying that he sacked him, and the official term, given Brunswijk's role within the military, is to say that he was discharged. 2 years later, in 1986, Brunswijk went to war with his old boss, and I don't mean that figuratively. He literally formed his own militia, a guerrilla group known as Jungle Commando, who joined forces with the Tucayana Amazonas to wage a 6-year civil war against the National Army and Butese's government, which became known as the Surinamese Interior War. Brunswijk didn't say that his guerrilla group, nor the war with Butese, was motivated by his pay denial and subsequent dismissal, claiming that, rather, he was motivated by a desire to bring about equal rights for Suriname's minority Maroon population. Though, you'd imagine the personal animosity played some role. God knows, there have been times when I've been trying to negotiate with my boss over the amount of ad revenue that I should get from this channel, given that I write, research, edit, narrate, produce, and promote all of the videos on my own, in which I've wondered whether it might just be easier to recruit a few of you as foot soldiers and march down to London ourselves to wage war against him. And if he were not only to say no, but to sack me as well, then, well, I don't doubt that that could push me over the edge. I am being glib, since the Maroons did have some pretty legitimate grievances against Butese, and the war did end up taking the lives of hundreds of civilians, whilst a further 10,000 fled to neighbouring French Guyana as refugees. After territory had been seized, lost, and seized again, and numerous crimes against humanity committed, a peace treaty was signed and agreed upon in 1992. Not only did the conflict result in numerous deaths and displacements, it also saw enormous disruption to bauxite mining, which formed the backbone of Suriname's economy. Consequently, the economic hardships that had existed before Butese's coup were exacerbated tenfold, whilst the country was at war with itself, and both sides had to seek alternative funding in order to keep fighting. The solution that both sides came up with was drug trafficking, as cocaine began to fund the conflict. At the end of the 1990s, long after a peace treaty was agreed, Brunswijk was convicted in absentia of running a cocaine smuggling ring by a court in the Netherlands. And a year later, a court in France came to the same conclusion, the first of which saw him sentenced to 8 years in prison, which was later reduced to 6 years upon appeal, with an Interpol arrest warrant put out for Brunswijk. Butese was convicted on similar charges by Suriname's former colonial rulers, with an even longer sentence of 11 years in his case. When the WikiLeaks cables were released in 2011, they alleged that Butese had been active in the drugs trade as recently as 2006, 14 years after the war in Suriname had ended, and at the time of those leaks, Butese was Suriname's president. Both men are currently safe in Suriname, who don't extradite their citizens, but would be at risk of arrest and extradition were they to leave the South American nation. Brunswijk, for the record, rejects all accusations of involvement in the drugs trade, claiming that his vast personal fortune, which makes him one of the wealthiest people in Suriname, can be attributed to concessions he obtained through gold mining and timber following the war. As part of the peace treaty with Brunswijk in 1992, jobs in the army, mining, and forestry sectors were offered to the Maroon people, and Brunswijk has since had personal involvement in these industries, and particularly gold. Through his wealth and alleged, or indeed convicted, crimes, Brunswijk has cultivated a reputation for himself as a Robin Hood-like figure among Suriname's Maroon population, stealing from the rich and giving money to the poor. Make no mistake, this is a reputation Brunswijk has not particularly subtly sought to create for himself. He once flew a helicopter above his supporters, showering them with money from the skies, which is just one example among many of a Pablo Escobar-style giving spree. In his early years, following the fallout with Butese, Brunswijk was convicted of bank robbery and of armed theft, redirecting much of the proceeds from those crimes to his local community. It is at this point that we return to football, I know, it's about time, since the beautiful game is another area in which Brunswijk has utilised his deep pockets in order to further extend his popularity and local support. Brunswijk became the owner of Inter Mongatapo in the early 2000s, who were a no-mark team in Suriname at the time. Suriname is a chunk of Amazonian jungle and coastal swampland that is a little larger than England in terms of land mass, but roughly 80 times less densely populated, which makes it one of the least densely populated countries in the entire world. Suriname's population is very heavily concentrated in the country's capital of Paramaribo, and so too is the nation's footballing talent, or was at least, until Brunswijk came on the scene. After his takeover of Inter Mongatapo, Brunswijk built the team a new 5,000 capacity stadium in 2002, which he very humbly named the Ronnie Brunswijk Stadion. 5,000 is a considerable capacity for IMT, as they are commonly known, given the fact that the town in which they are based, Mongo, which is just a stone's throw away from where Brunswijk was born, has a population of just 7,000 people. To continue the analogy with English football, that would be the equivalent of Valley Parade, the home of Bradford City, having a capacity of almost 400,000. Brunswijk's investment into IMT has made them the dominant force in Suriname's football over the last two decades, as the club went on a run of winning 10 league titles in the space of just 12 years between 2007 and 2019, making them the third most successful club in the history of Suriname's top flight. No other team who played their home games outside of Paramaribo have even won multiple league titles since the league was founded under Dutch colonial control in 1924, just to put that success into some context. Whilst last week was the first time in more than a decade that Brunswijk has actually appeared in a competitive fixture for the club that he owns, his fondness for the sport beyond its ability to increase his own public support is no secret. Once or twice, his love of the game has spilt over into slightly overzealous acts, such as when he was suspended for 5 years by the Surinamese FA for threatening players with a handgun during a game in 2005, though that suspension was later dropped due to a lack of evidence. A year later, though, a one-year suspension for acting violently towards a referee was not. Brunswijk's title might officially be owner of IMT, but at times he has been a player, manager, coach, captain, chairman, CEO, supporter, sponsor, and indeed hooligan. His latest suspension arrived just days ago, not from the Surinamese FA this time, but from a higher power, CONCACAF. Not because he decided to start a game in central midfield in CONCACAF's second biggest club competition, which is the regional equivalent of the UEFA Europa League, though they weren't best pleased about the optics of that either, but his suspension came as a consequence of Brunswijk's behaviour after the game, caught on camera and shared on social media by a similarly intriguing figure with an equally colourful past. Brunswijk played 54 minutes for IMT against Honduran outfit CD Olympia, wearing the number 61 shirt as a nod to the year in which he was born, and substituting himself off, to be replaced by his own son, when IMT were already 4-0 down. If you were wondering which of his children Brunswijk was replaced by, which would be a legitimate question given that he has at least 50 of them and perhaps many more, but the one who replaced him was 21-year-old Damien Brunswijk. You might think that the IMT players would have been irritated by Brunswijk making a difficult game up against Olympia in the CONCACAF League even more difficult by making himself captain and a starter. And perhaps they were, but they kept pretty shtum about it, given the fact that he is the man who pays their wages, and he even bought every member of the IMT squad a new car not all that long ago. Anyhow, what really alarmed CONCACAF and prompted them to take action was Brunswijk getting caught on camera handing out wads of cash to the Olympia players in their dressing room following the final whistle, in which his team had just lost to them 6-0. This video was shared and later deleted, though it was too late by that point, by Joel Martinez, who is a man described on the Dutch version of Wikipedia as, quote, a Surinamese football club owner, entertainer, convicted drug dealer, and politician, which, again, is quite the description. You might think that offering out cash indiscriminately is par for the course by Brunswijk standards, and you would be right. but in a part of the world where football has been plagued by corruption and accusations of match-fixing, handing out money to a team who just beat you 6-0 is not a particularly good look, and CONCACAF immediately began investigating the matter. They have since kicked both teams out of the competition and have banned Brunswijk from participating in any CONCACAF competition for the next 3 years. Which isn't so bad, I suppose. By then, he'll be 63, well-rested, and coming into his peak. After all, according to Wikipedia, Suriname's vice president completed 14 out of the 17 passes that he attempted before removing himself and allowing his son a chance to try and distribute the ball as accurately as his old man against Olympia. So, you know, it would be foolish to think that he was finished just yet. You might still be wondering how Ronnie Brunswijk, IMT's owner, club captain and chief car buyer, ever managed to become Suriname's vice president in the first place. What with him being, you know, a wanted international criminal and all. Well, after the war that he waged against the Surinamese government ended and Brunswijk became very rich and very popular among the Maroon minority for redistributing some of that wealth to those communities and at least being perceived to represent them on a national level, he decided to enter politics. His popularity saw him elected, and though Brunswijk doesn't command the nationwide support required to win, say, a general election, he has spent more than a decade acting effectively as a kingmaker for the major parties and politicians in Suriname. In 2020, Suriname's new president, Chan Santokki, who replaced the departing Desi Bouterse, brought Brunswijk officially into government for the first time, as Brunswijk was nominated by the coalition as vice president in an uncontested election. So that is it for today's video, but thank you all very much as ever for watching. I know it was a bit of a different one, but I guess that's sort of the way that this channel works. Hit the like button if you enjoyed it, let me know your thoughts down below in the comments, and make sure, of course, it goes without saying, that you are subscribed and have notifications turned on for HITC Sevens. You can also find me on Twitter and on Instagram via the username at HITC Sevens on both, should you wish to do so.